There was a minister walking down the street one Sunday afternoon when he noticed a very small boy trying to ring the doorbell on a house across the street. The problem is that the doorbell is a little too high for the little boy to reach. After watching the boy's efforts, the minister decided to walk over and give him a hand. So he crosses the street, goes up to the house, and gives the bell a solid ring. Crouching down to the little boy's level, the minister smiled benevolently and asked, "And now what, my little man?" To which the boy responded, "Now we run." A young man was visiting the church for the first time, checking all the announcements and posters along the wall in the foyer. When he came to a group of pictures of men in uniform, he asked the nearby usher, "Who are all these men in the pictures?" The usher replied, "Well, those are boys from our church who died in the service." Dumbfounded and in a panic, the youngster asked, "Was it the 8:30 service or the 10:45 service?" So you have to wonder, I usually do one joke. I struggled with this text, so I put two jokes in. So listen. Last month, I attended a festival of homiletics in Atlanta. It's a week-long educational conference for preaching, preparation, and styles. We observed from the best of the best, from Will Wibbleman, Walter Brueggemann, David Loesch, Caroline Lewis, Bruce Reyes Chow, and many others as they preached a specific text during worship each day. And then we learned during daily lectures how to tackle specific texts found in the lectionary selections. We shall see if anything rubbed off. But one statistic we learned, most likely knew, that years ago, regular attendance at church was someone attending every week. But nowadays, regular attendance in church is one in every six Sundays. But don't get any ideas, you're above average people. However, the one thing that was suggested for those one in six week attendees, it was suggested that we use a tactic that Hollywood uses, say, previously on NCIS. So previously, at Parkway Hills. We have been away from the lectionary these past five Sundays, and Bruce explored the five words you can't live without. Can you name them for me? Deeply so proud. So today we return to our lectionary text from the Gospel of Luke, and we find the message of grace, love, faith, church, and mission continues. And we just may find another word or two that we cannot live without. So hear these words from the Gospel of Luke. One of the Pharisees invited Jesus to eat with him. After he entered the Pharisee's home, he took his place at the table. Meanwhile, a woman from the city, a sinner, discovered that Jesus was dining in the Pharisee's house. She brought perfumed oil in a vase made of alabaster. Standing behind him at his feet and crying, she began to wet his feet with her tears. She wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured the oil on them. When the Pharisee who had invited Jesus saw what was happening, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know what kind of woman is touching him. He would know that she is a sinner." Jesus replied, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher, speak," he said. "A certain lender had two debtors. One owed enough money to pay 500 people for a day's work. The other owed enough money for 50. When they couldn't pay, the lender forgave the debts of both. Which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the largest debt canceled." Jesus said, "You have judged correctly." Jesus turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? When I entered your home, you didn't give me water for my feet, but she wet my feet with tears and wiped them with her hair. You didn't greet me with a kiss, but she hasn't stopped kissing my feet since I came in. You didn't anoint my head with oil, but she has poured perfume oil on my feet. This is why I tell you that her many sins have been forgiven, so she has shown great love. The one who is forgiven little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other table guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this person that even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." May God bless the reading, hearing, and understanding of these words. Let us pray. Almighty and holy God, we come into your presence this day broken and bruised from our week, frustrated and energyless. May this hour and the message we receive from you make us whole and rejuvenate us today and throughout the week ahead as we take your love and grace with us each and every day. Amen. Have you ever planned a dinner party where you had an important, well-known guest that was the highlight of the evening? How hard did you work to have that the most perfect evening? You wanted everything to go right and go as planned with no snafus. So imagine you had invited guests in your home for dinner and suddenly someone entered your dining room uninvited and unexpected. You wouldn't be very happy regardless of who it was. So we understand Simon and his shock as this woman with a known reputation around town enters and kneels at the feet of Jesus, Simon's honored guest. Our response would definitely be, who does she think she is? So Simon is wondering the same thing about Jesus, his special guest from Nazareth. Simon, a Pharisee, invited Jesus to his home for dinner and discussion, which was a common practice in those days between religious leaders and teachers. Much like the discussions we have with our friends when we get together, we all have different takes on every subject, especially church, and different things nowadays. We really don't know if Simon was a friend or foe of Jesus' teaching, nor do we know if Simon genuinely wanted to hear more from him. We do know, however, and discover that Simon was not particularly a good host, and he was very critical of Jesus. It was custom in those days to greet your guests with a kiss, offer them water for cleansing their feet from their long, dusty journey, and anoint their tired, dry skin with oil. But Simon did none of this. Simon and his guests are reclining at the table, and perhaps dinner is in the process of being served when this woman, a known sinner, enters the home of the Pharisee uninvited. She wets Jesus' feet with her tears, pours oil over his feet, and unbinds her hair to dry his feet, an act of love and hospitality. Aside from the fact that a woman crashed a party, a reputable woman would never uncover her hair before strangers. All of her actions are scandalous. But she notices the basics of welcoming and showing love and hospitality toward the guests had not been done by the host, which is scandalous in its own right. But having heard the message from Jesus about the love and grace of God, she takes the risk and shows her love for Jesus by washing, kissing, and anointing his feet after his long journey. Scandalous behavior with many risks. At this point, Simon doesn't think Jesus is a prophet because he lets this sinner touch him. Simon doesn't understand the true nature of God's love and acceptance, for he would have rejected the woman and deemed her unworthy of God's love and forgiveness. But Jesus can tell by the look on Simon's face and the silence at the table that the Pharisee would dismiss this woman instead of forgiving her sins. So Jesus shares the story of the two debtors. Simon recognizes that the one debtor with the largest debt is forgiven the most and will love more. Jesus wants us to realize that we are all like the woman coming to Jesus with a large debt. Our healing comes when we pour out our love for others as Jesus did. Pour out our love for others as we provide beds for Madison County kids who have never slept so well. Provide needed nourishment on weekends for elementary students. students just trying to learn, provide children the basics of luggage for their stuff as they move from foster home to foster home dignity. Simple acts of God's love and mercy for others. The woman knows that the story of the debtors is about her. As far as sin, she is a huge debtor, and everyone knows it. The unexpected twist in the story is what the two debtors have in common. Neither could pay up, but both were forgiven. But Jesus is also talking about Simon, for he is also a debtor like the woman. She hears Jesus pointedly tell Simon that while he neglected his duties as host, this woman has welcomed Jesus with love and displays of hospitality, which was the custom. Then Jesus turns to the woman and says, "Your sins are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." The woman does not hear the murmurs of the other guests grumbling at the audacity of Jesus forgiving sins. Filled with radiant peace, she practically walks on air all the way home. So what is our calling in this world as lay people and as clergy? In this world of anger, hate, war, violence against each other, name-calling, gossip, you fill in the next blank. What is Jesus showing us to do about social injustice, inadequate educational systems, children without the simplest basic items such as a bed for good rest or food for nourishment and learning, equal rights for minorities and women, some simple acts of love never considered such as luggage to foster children so they don't have to put their clothes in a trash bag as they move from home to home? What is Jesus calling us to do in this modern society where we neglect the homeless, the working poor, those in prison, and the marginalized? Jesus calls us by example to be forgiving, loving, and hospitable toward each other, to be humble and kind, to love your neighbor as yourself. In Jesus' time, there was hate, anger, class distinctions, and gossip as well. But Jesus showed by his actions to be forgiving and loving toward each other and to be humble and kind. Jesus also taught us to pray daily. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. We say it every Sunday. We say it every day. And Jesus' ultimate forgiveness came on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So why is it so difficult for us to take the first step to forgiveness? Scarlett Lewis's son, Jesse, was killed in the 2012 Sandy Hook shootings, the biggest school shooting in U.S. history. At first, her anger zapped all her strength and energy. She was angry at the shooter, angry at the mother for unwittingly harming him. She had made a choice to forgive. She told the Forgiveness Project, "Forgiveness felt like I was given a big pair of scissors to cut the tie and regain my personal power. It started with a choice and then became a process." She urged mourners at Jesse's funeral to change their angry thoughts into loving ones, thus changing the world. What would you have done? What will you do? And who can forget the response after the murders at Emmanuel Amy Church during a Bible study in Charleston, South Carolina last year? A few days after the shooting, family members of victims forgave the shooter through video feed. Here's what some said. Dave Collier, daughter of victim Ethel Lance, said, "I forgive you. You took something very precious away from me. I will never get to talk to her ever again. I will never be able to hold her again. But I forgive you. You hurt me. You hurt a lot of people. If God forgives you, I forgive you." Another relative of Myra Thompson said, "I forgive him, and my family forgives him." Can you imagine how difficult this was? What would you have done? What will you do? Forgiving is not easy. It is not going to be easy. Acts against us or toward others, by us, can be small things, large things, stupid things, and disputes that linger for years where we don't even remember why we're fighting. But what does God call us to do? What did Jesus show us to do? Love. Forgive. Take the first step, no matter what. Hold your tongue if you're angry. Always wait before you respond. Love your neighbor as yourself. Be humble and kind. Here are some of these words, again, from our modern-day theologian, Tim McGraw. Don't expect a free ride from no one. Don't hold a grudge or a chip, and here's why. Bitterness keeps you from flying. Always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't cheat, don't lie. I know you've got mountains to climb, but always stay humble and kind. When those dreams you're dreaming come to you, when the work you put in is realized, let yourself feel the pride, but always stay humble and kind. When it's hot, eat a root beer popsicle. Shut off the AC and roll the windows down. Let that summer sun shine. Always stay humble and kind. Don't take for granted the love this life gives you. And when you get where you're going, don't forget to turn back around and help the next one in line. Always stay humble and kind. Let us pray. Dear God, keep us mindful of your love and your sacrifice to forgive our sins. Guide us so that in all our relationship, love, forgiveness, and hospitality will prevail, and you will be glorified each and every day.